friends, have you any idea what the subject is about tonight? It's called the new taboo. Well, I'll give you a hint or two. There was a man who was married for the fourth time. His previous wives died. And when he took his new wife into the house, he opened a closet and he showed her three hats, women's hats. And he said, "Those hats belonged to my former wives." And she said, "The next hat that goes in there is a derby." Have you guessed it yet? No, it's not on marriage. So I'll give you another hint. In Virginia is a tombstone. I do not have the names exactly, nor the date, so I will make up a couple of names. But on the tombstone, one reads, "Mary Patterson died May the 11th, 1863, and underneath it, waiting for you." And then below, "John Peterson died September the 24th, 1864. Now someone, not very long ago, with a penknife, scratched at the bottom of the last date, late as usual. Well, you know what the taboo used to be in the last century? The taboo in the last century was sex. We were not supposed to talk about it. And it was said that if we'd only talk about it and bring it out into the open, we'd have no more problems. Well, it was not quite that simple. But that taboo is finished. What is the one subject about which one must not speak today? What's the new taboo? Death. It's not going to be morbid. Don't shut it off. It's not going to be that bad. People today are awkward in the presence of death. Centuries gone by, we were always told, memento mori, remember the hour of death. Now one is not supposed to refer to it, and if one does, it always is spoken of in terms of green fields and richer pastures and so forth. We cover it up cosmetically, disguise it. Remember particularly the body of Lenin. Here the communists deny immortality, but periodically they have to inject the body of Lenin with wax so that they who deny immortality give a queer kind of mortality to this body. So they cover up death, making him alive. Incidentally, did you know that a lot of trouble there was when Khrushchev dug up the body of Stalin? Remember that? And since that time, they don't know where to put Stalin. And the present dictators of Russia are moving Stalin from here and there and so forth, trying to find a place for him. Not very long ago, one of the dictators of Russia went to Israel. And he said to the president of Israel, "We got this body of Stalin. We don't know what to do with it. Can we bury him here in Israel?" And the president of Israel said, "Well, all right. We will allow him to be buried here." And it took 3 days to make the arrangements. And when the dictator of Russia went back, he was very happy. But as he got on the plane, president of Israel said to the Russian dictator, he said, I want you to know that we have the highest resurrection rate in the world. Now, what's the reason for covering up the subject of death and making it a taboo? Well, this is the reason. We used to consider, and thank heavens many of us still do, the span of life as having, at the beginning, birth, and at the end, death. Now, when people thought of life this way, they always had to ask two questions. Namely, where did I come from? And where am I going? Now, today, they ignore these two. No more questions of origin or of destiny. I was going to ask my angel to erase these two, but since Milton Berle came back on television, he's got another set backstage listening to Milton Berle. But these two now are out, so that what do you have left? You only have this span. And this span, without the question of origin and destiny, is rather meaningless. In fact, it's absurd. And that's one of the reasons why one must never speak of the end of a meaningless existence. But we have to talk about it. And we're going to try to get some insights into this problem from three fields. One, the field of psychiatry. The other, the field of evolution. And the other, from God is dead ism. Those three. First, psychiatry. What insight does that give us concerning death? Well, in order to get psychiatric help, the best one to appeal to would be someone who lived close to death, who saw tens of thousands go to death, violent deaths. And he should also be a learned man and a psychiatrist. And that man was the Jewish psychiatrist, Dr. Viktor Frankl. Dr. Viktor Frankl was in Auschwitz. He was not only in this particular concentration camp, but he also suffered under the communists. And he wrote his observations in a book. And this is what he revealed. That people could take any kind of suffering so long as they could see a future. So he said when some prisoners dreamed that they might be released on a certain day, their health picked up. And even under starvation, they were strong. And then, of course, if they were not released on that day, then they collapsed. And other times, he said, rumors would be spread in camps. And as the rumors would be spread about release on a certain date, everyone was strong. Dr. Frankl quoted Nietzsche to the effect that you can bear any how if you only know the why. He told of one woman who looked out through her prison bars at a tree, and she said, I don't mind anything now. That's living. I see life. Life is eternal. But he says, just as soon as people lost what he called a moral ordering, a goal, a destiny, they immediately began to disintegrate. So long as they had it, they were strong. Very much like a boy that's given a toy balloon. If he's told it's the only balloon he's ever going to have, he can't play with it too much. He must be careful not to puncture it. Afraid the air may blow out. But suppose he's told, well, maybe in another year, 2 years, maybe tomorrow, you'll be given another balloon that will give you infinite pleasure, that will never explode, never disappoint you. The reaction of the boy will be, well, I don't care about the first balloon. And so it is with something beyond that ordering toward a destiny of which Dr. Frankl spoke. So long as there is that goal, one can stand the trials of life. And you carry that on to a future goal that is promised, and there'll never be disappointment. That's the insight of psychiatry. Now, the insight of evolution. There's a law that runs through the universe. And the law is, that in order to live in a higher kingdom, one must die to a lower one. If the plants could speak, they would say to the carbonates, to the carbons, to the phosphate, to the sulfur, to the sunlight, to the rain, unless you die to yourself, you cannot live in my kingdom. But if you surrender that chemical existence of yours, you'll begin to live in me and enjoy my vegetable life. And if plants, animals could speak, they would say to the plants, if you were just content to be torn up from the roots, ground beneath the jaws of death, then you'll cease to be a vegetable, then you'll begin to live in a sentient being such as I am. And man says to the lower creatures, if you begin to die to your lower self, your chemical existence, plant life, animal life, you can live in me. Why, you'll be a part of a thinking, loving being that can scan the stars, appreciate poetry, and help amorize the universe. Now, should this evolutionary process stop? These things are forced to die. But if this world is the constant progress toward that which is betterment and toward love itself, should there not be someone to whom man himself can die? But in the case of man, should it not be voluntary? So that he himself would say, I am prepared to die to that which is base in me in order that I may live in that which is higher. Here there would be a complete act of freedom which does not exist in the lower order. So that what corresponds to the struggle for existence in the lower order is sacrifice in the higher order. So that the condition, therefore, of real happiness and real peace is to follow out this evolutionary order so that we develop what almost might be called a kind of an excentration. Excentration, getting out of center, getting out of the center of the ego. Dying like a seed in order to live to another life. This is the promise of evolution, and this is the logic of the universe. And those who will follow that logic through knows the answer, what dying means to live again. Then, there is the God is dead-ism. There are some things that every man must do for himself. Sleep his own sleep, blow his own nose, make his own love, and die his own death. Death is the one thing that no one has ever experienced. has ever gone through it. Therefore, death is not a problem, it's a mystery. A problem is always something outside of us, namely how send a rocket to the moon. That's a problem. A mystery is something that involves me, and death is a mystery. So, since no human has ever been through this, it seems as if, well, there ought to be something in the universe that might be likened to that which my mother used to do when I had to take castor oil. I can still taste it when I speak of it. You put it in orange juice and it is still castor oil. But I remember my mother would say, see, I'll taste it first. It's not bad, not bad. I know it choked her, as it did me. Now, that's the only way the problem of mystery is ever going to be solved. You know that? Someone has got to taste it. Taste it and come through it. In other words, in a certain sense, God has to take his own medicine. There is no other way. But in order to make this convincing, you know what we have to have first? We have to have a group of men that belong to a movement that might be called God is Dead-ism. In other words, we have to have, first of all, an absolute certitude that God is dead. They've got to be professors, associated with religious groups and schools, learned men, lawyers, writers. Contributors to periodicals. They have to be men who make profound investigations. And the kind of men who can give us some assurance that God is dead. They will make a great contribution to the cause if they will call on civil authorities, set a watch, seal a tomb, meet men with bayonets, stand alongside of a sepulcher. These God is dead men must make this proclamation. They must sign a warrant. And say that there was nothing ever that was more dead. We've got to review all the circumstances of the death. Point to the instrument in which he died. Fumble around with hammers and nails and the like. Say, this is the proof. He's dead. And they should have a president, the God is Deaders. President, too, should come from inside this group. And he should be a type of man who would say, listen, I am not going to believe anything simply because somebody tells me. I'm not going to believe witnesses. The only kind of a God that I'm ever going to believe in is some kind of a God who's taken the worst that this world can ever give. I want to see his life preceded by ignominy, by contempt, by rebuttal from my fellow God is deaders. I want to see all of that because the only God that I will ever accept is one who has scars, one who's been through it, one who blasted open the doors of death. Let him come before me. Let him stand. Let him say, all right, you will not believe that a man has been at war because he wears medals. Will you believe a man who shows his scars? Here they are like stars on hands and feet and side. Will you believe that? Sure, God is dead. And he appears with the stars to say, I've been through it. This is your hope. This is your life. Why, there's never been a tear that has flowed down your cheek, but that it flowed through mine. You've never had a pain. But I have suffered at all of your deaths. My death. The death of every flower is my death. I've been through it. I suffered it all. I had to fear it. I had even to brave a certain kind of abandonment. Yes, I have passed through it. And so I thank all of you men who a few days ago said, God is dead. That's the answer to the taboo of death. Now turn the page. He's not dead. He's risen. See the place where they laid him.
Bishop Sheen will return in a moment.
Psychiatrist Dr. Viktor Frankl. Dr. Viktor Frankl was in Auschwitz. He was not only in this particular concentration camp, but he also suffered under the communists. And he wrote his observations in a book. And this is what he revealed. That people could take any kind of suffering so long as they could see a future. So he said when some prisoners dreamed that they might be released on a certain day, their health picked up. And even under starvation, they were strong. And then, of course, if they were not released on that day, then they collapsed. And other times, he said, rumors would be spread in camps. And as the rumors would be spread about release on a certain date, everyone was strong. Dr. Frankl quoted Nietzsche to the effect that you can bear any how if you only know the why. He told of one woman who looked out through her prison bars at a tree. And she said, I don't mind anything now. That's living. I see life. Life is eternal. But he said, just as soon as people lost what he called a moral ordering, a goal, a destiny, they immediately began to disintegrate. So long as they had it, they were strong. Very much like a boy that's given a toy balloon. If he's told it's the only balloon he's ever going to have, he can't play with it too much. He must be careful not to puncture it. Afraid the air may blow out. Leaders of Russia are moving Stalin from here and there and so forth, trying to find a place for him. Not very long ago, one of the dictators of Russia went to Israel. and he said to the president of Israel, we got this body of Stalin, we don't know what to do with it. Can we bury him here in Israel? And the president of Israel said, well, all right, we will allow him to be buried here. And it took 3 days to make the arrangements. And when the dictator of Russia went back, he was very happy. But as he got on the plane, the president of Israel said to the Russian dictator, he said, I want you to know that we have the highest resurrection rate in the world. Now, what's the reason for covering up the subject of death and making it a taboo? Well, this is the reason. We used to consider, and thank heavens many of us still do, the span of life as having, at the beginning, birth, and at the end, death. Now, when people thought of life this way, they always had to ask two questions. Namely, where did I come from? And where am I going? Now today, they ignore these two. No more questions of origin or of destiny. I was going to ask my angel to erase these two, but since Milton Berle came back on television, he's got another set backstage listening to Milton Berle. But these two now are out, so that what do you have left? You only have this span. And this span, without the question of origin and destiny, is rather meaningless. In fact, it's absurd. And that's one of the reasons why one must never speak of the end of a meaningless existence. But we have to talk about it. And we're going to try to get some insights into this problem in three fields. One, the field of psychiatry. The other, the field of evolution. And the other, from God is dead ism. Those three. First, psychiatry. What insight does that give us concerning death? Well, in order to get psychiatric help, the best one to appeal to would be someone who lived close to death, who saw tens of thousands go to death, violent deaths. And he should also be a learned man and a psychiatrist. And that man was the Jewish, not supposed to talk about it. And it was said that if we'd only talk about it and bring it out into the open, we'd have no more problems. Well, it was not quite that simple. But that taboo is finished. What is the one subject about which one must not speak today? What's the new taboo? Death. It's not going to be more, but don't shut it off. It's not going to be that bad. People today are awkward in the presence of death. They, In centuries gone by, we were always told, memento mori, remember the hour of death. Now one is not supposed to refer to it, and if one does, it always is spoken of in terms of green fields and richer pastures and so forth. We cover it up cosmetically, disguise it. Remember particularly the body of Lenin. Here the communists deny immortality, but periodically they have to inject the body of Lenin with wax, so that they who deny immortality give a queer kind of mortality to this body. So they cover up death, making him alive. Incidentally, you know that a lot of trouble there was when Khrushchev dug up the body of Stalin. Remember that? And since that time, they don't know where to put Stalin. And the prison dictator. Friends, have you any idea what the subject is about tonight? It's called The New Taboo. Well, I'll give you a hint or two. There was a man who was married for the fourth time. His previous wives died. And when he took his new wife into the house, he opened a closet and he showed her three hats, women's hats. And he said, "Those hats belonged to my former wives." And she said, "The next hat that goes in there is a derby." Have you guessed it yet? No, it's not on marriage. So I'll give you another hint. In Virginia is a tombstone. I do not have the names exactly, nor the date, so I will make up a couple of names. But on the tombstone, one reads, "Mary Patterson died May the 11th, 1863, and underneath it, waiting for you." And then below, "John Peterson died September the 24th, 1864. Now someone, not very long ago, with a penknife, scratched at the bottom of the last date, late as usual. Well, you know what the taboo used to be in the last century? The taboo in the last century was sex.